and welcome. So today we are here to talk about the viola music of Hans Werner Henze. He's got three principal pieces for our instrument, and along with Zach Lopes, I'll be playing his sonata for viola and piano, and I'll also be playing one of his solo works. Our goal today is to trace the path of viola music throughout Henze's career, and to draw out some of the tendencies that he has for writing for our instrument. I think that among 20th century composers, Henze really wrote for the viola rather than writing for a big-sized violin or a small-sized cello. He wrote for the instrument in a way that exploited its wonderful characteristics, that beautiful middle voice quality that I think we all love. So a little bit about Henze's life. His major type of composition was theatrical music, or music for the stage. He wrote no fewer than 28 operas or musical theater works, and he was always interested in writing for the voice and writing with drama, gesture, and kind of speaking quality. And he actually talked about this in a pre-concert lecture in the St. Paul Chamber Orchestra in 1977. He said, quote, "When I am supposed to write music without words, I always find myself in a difficulty. I never know what abstract music really is. I cannot see the difference between music without words and music with words. I cannot conceive of music without a meaning, not only without a grammar and a syntax." So even when he was writing instrumental music, he was thinking in this verbally expressive way. And we'll hear that throughout a lot of his works today. In terms of his life, he was born in 1926 in Western Germany. And as we all know, that was a very fraught period in world history. And his family suffered greatly. The Nazi ideology found its way into his home in the way of his father, who became a avowed Nazi party member. And Henze writes very vividly about seeing the great works of literature become replaced on his family's bookshelves by Nazi propaganda, anti-Jewish works. His father actually played the viola, and Henze, in his first mature piece, which was his first symphony, includes a great viola solo in the slow movement. And perhaps that was a sort of nod to his father. People interested in Henze and scholars of Henze are very lucky because he was a prolific writer. He left behind an incredible autobiography, one of the most enjoyable to read. And in this autobiography, which in English is called Bohemian Fits, he shares not only like the details of his life, but also gives a window into his emotional struggles and his inner life. He was a man who felt emotions incredibly strongly and suffered in a way from a lot of those emotions. In terms of as a composer, he wrote in a sense of free tonality. He was very much involved in 12-tone music early in his life, and he fully assumed that style. But he later grew away from it, choosing to write a sort of free atonality instead of the strict ideas of total serialism. So in terms of his viola works, he's got three major pieces. His first work is a concerto entitled Compases para preguntas ensimismadas. His second piece is the sonata for viola and piano, which Zach and I will be playing today. And his last piece is a short solo work called An Brenton. We'll also be looking at a serenade, which is originally a cello piece that was arranged for viola, and the slow movement of his fourth string quartet. And before going too much into details, there's two people that were a big influence for me in working on this project. And that is the violinist, violist, and scholar Peter Shepard Scarabid, and the great violist Garth Knox. When I was the editor of the Journal of the American Viola Society, I reached out to Peter about writing an article about George Rochberg, with whom he'd worked very closely. Peter said he didn't really play the Rochberg Viola Sonata, but he had just recorded the Henze Viola Sonata, and he offered to write a piece for the journal. And what resulted was this beautiful piece of writing from Peter that mixes his personal history with Henze and an analysis of the piece. So if you're at all interested in Henze, you have to go read that article, which is found in the 2018 summer issue of the journal. And also, Garth Knox was the inspiration for the dedicatee and the first performer of this viola sonata. And without Garth's incredible way of playing and creating sound and creating a musical line, I don't think Henze would have been inspired to write this piece. I'd also like to thank Garth for spending some time with me to talk about his involvement with the sonata. He was very open with his recollections and his memories about this period. So the first work that we're going to start with is actually Henze's last work for viola, and that's entitled An Brenton. Throughout his life, Henze wrote a variety of pieces for special occasions, whether that was a thank you note to somebody, an elegy, or even a wedding present. And this work he wrote in July 1993, following the death of his friend, the violinist Brenton Langman. And Brenton was an Australian-born violinist who spent most of his life in Switzerland. He was the leader of Paul Sacher's Collegium Musicum in Zurich. He worked closely with Henze, and Henze wrote his second violin concerto for him and dedicated it to him. In this black and white photo here, you can see Brenton in the middle, and he's flanked by Henze and Paul Sacher. And he's in costume following a performance of the second violin concerto, which has a theatrical element to it. As I said, they worked very closely, and upon his death, Henze was quite affected. And this gives you a little sense of the tone that we'll encounter in this piece. Henze wrote in his autobiography, "This dear friend died only recently, blown away like a handful of dust." And that image of dust blowing away gives you this sort of feeling of just unfillable emptiness that we'll hear in the beginning and end of this piece. The final question about this piece is, why would Henze write a viola piece in memory of a violinist? There's not really an answer, and if Henze had an answer, he definitely wouldn't have told us. So I can come up with a couple different reasons. One, our instrument is, for better or worse, associated with elegies. There's multiple CDs entitled Elegy of Viola Music. And this is true not just for other composers, but also for Henze himself. He used the viola as an elegiac instrument throughout his career. And specifically, just 2 years before this piece, he wrote a moving viola solo in his Requiem Mass in the Agnus Dei movement. Then, in terms of a more personal answer to this question, I wonder if writing for the viola provided Henze with a little bit of an emotional buffer for writing for his violinist friend. Maybe writing for one instrument removed from the violin gave him a way to deal with his grief rather than writing for that specific instrument. There's two musical features that I'd like to call to your attention about this piece. One is the use of the saraband rhythm. As we all know, the saraband is a type of rhythm where we have one short beat and one long beat. And what Henze uses is exactly the same rhythm we find in Bach's first saraband for solo cello, the G major saraband. So this first measure here, this rhythm of the first measure of the Bach appears in all of these red squares on the slide. And you can see it very clearly that way. So in this one I've broken out here, here's what it sounds like. Exactly this rhythm, Henze offers various permutations of it, and those can be seen in the blue boxes here. What I find most amazing that he does is in the green boxes. If you look at the lower one, what Henze does is replace the first beat of the saraband rhythm with a rest, which gives us that feeling of loss or empty. some sort of hole there. And then in the green box in the middle of the page, this is the most almost violent and striking moment of the piece. And you can even visually see the almost the obverse effect of the saraband rhythm, the long rest and the short rest. And I think what Henze is doing is writing the ghost of the saraband, just like he felt the ghost of his dear friend. The final way that he uses the saraband is on the phrase structure. And you can see that down on the bottom left, where we have one short entrance and one long entrance. Henze's other musical device in this piece is using open fifths. As Peter wrote in his article for the journal, whenever Henze was writing for a string instrument, the Berg Violin Concerto was never far from his mind. And the Berg Violin Concerto famously begins with the four open strings of the instrument. So Henze uses open fifths in this piece, I think, to bridge the gap between Brenton, the violinist, and viola that he was writing for. So he writes a couple violin fifths with open D and A, plus A and E, and then the piece ends with viola open fifths. And in one of the most beautiful parts of the piece, probably the warmest and richest sonority, Henze combines the violin and the viola's notes. So if we imagine the viola strings over here, the violin strings over here, and then the three in between. So the viola has the C, the violin has the E, and the middle note that they share is the D. And in that very bottom starburst, Henze combines those three notes. And interestingly, he puts the viola on top and the violin on the bottom. So it's almost a symbolic way of joining these two instruments. So now I will perform this short work, Henze's An Brenton, for solo.
Thank you.
final piece for the instrument, but he actually has one adapted that was a little bit later, and that's his Serenade from 1949 that he adapted in 2003. And this was done at the suggestion of Garth Knox. Garth approached Henze about writing a new piece for viola, and Henze actually said, replied to Garth, that he was too old to write for the viola. Who knows what that means? So Garth asked him if he could make a transcription of this cello piece, which he had long admired. And Henze jumped at the idea, and more than just make a transcription, Henze kind of clarified his original intent. The cello version does not have any time signatures, there's hardly any dynamics, and there's barely any articulations. So Henze went through the piece and added a lot of this stuff, which you can see in all the in the viola version in the yellow highlighter here. And it gives the piece a much kind of sharper expression and clarifies a lot of his original intentions. The piece works great as a teaching piece because it's 9 movements long, but it only takes 10 minutes to play. So it really focuses your mind, focuses the student's mind to be immediately expressive without wasting a single second. So now that we've talked about his final pieces for viola, we can go to his very first piece for viola. And that is his viola concerto entitled Compases, Preguntas, Ensimismadas. And that beautiful title translates, in Henze's own translation, to meters for questions absorbed in self-contemplation. And if we were to translate that into more conversational English, it would be musical measures or bars looking inward. So it's a very introspective type of mood connoted in this title. During this period in Henze's life, he was very interested in communist politics and the communist ideals, especially in terms of elevating the lower class people, or basically bringing classes together and bringing people together and breaking down barriers between classes. He also sought to do that through music. And he wrote this piece while he was visiting Cuba, and there he premiered his 6th symphony with the musicians in Havana. But in terms of this piece, he wrote that he sought to overcome the division between soloists as individualists and orchestra players as an undifferentiated mass, not only in structure, but in practice. So this piece, we've got 22 instrumentalists that all have their own separate parts and a viola soloist. It's about a 25-minute single movement work, and it's in the form of a suite. And what we have is a viola introduction followed by a dance section, and then the central part of it is this viola song. And we'll hear the viola song not just in this piece, but also in his sonata. In terms of the opening gesture, we have another clear reference to the Berg violin concerto, which you can see at the bottom here. At the top, this is the opening viola part. These are the first 4 notes of the piece, and I didn't have to practice these very much. So you can see that very, very clear reference to Berg happens in this piece as well. So I brought 2 excerpts. The first is from the dance section of this piece. Henze called this a rumba, and I think it was a reflection of his time in Cuba. It's this wonderful combination of this really great groove plus 1960s modernist tonal language and articulations. So here's the recording Henze made with the violist Hirofumi Fukai and the London Sinfonietta. Thank you. play is that viola song in the middle. In it, the viola is singing its own tune, and other instruments kind of wander in and wander out, sometimes interacting with the viola, sometimes not. And this idea of either communication or not communication is something that's also present in the viola sonata. So here's this excerpt. It goes a little bit beyond the score up here. Continue tracing Henze's writing for viola, the next major piece that he wrote for our instrument is the slow movement of his fourth string quartet. So to put this in a little context, Henze was in New York City in 1973 conducting the premiere of Compases, the US premiere, and Walter Trempler was the soloist. And then a couple days after that concert, he went and attended a concert by the Concord String Quartet, playing Elliott Carter quartets. And Henze shared that this was he got the idea of writing a set of string quartets for these young musicians. And he was actually not the only composer that was inspired to write a set of quartets for the Concords. That was also George Rochberg. And there's a wonderful photo of George Rochberg working with the Concord String Quartet. And you can see clearly their violist, John Kokanowski, who was for many years a teacher at Vanderbilt University and one of my mentors. Following the premieres of these, let's just talk about the fourth string quartet now. So Henze calls this one of his most involved attempts on musical form, and it's about his relationship between him and all of musical history. So kind of a lofty goal here. The kind of conceit of this piece is that each movement has a leader or principal voice. So the first movement belongs to the cello, the second to the viola, the third to the second violin, and the final movement to the first violin. The second movement is our viola movement, and it's entitled William Byrd Pavana. The two violins and cello play the type of William Byrd tune, and the viola offers a sort of commentary or reflection or sometimes denial of this piece. And what you'll hear in this excerpt is Henze's very expressive and unique way of writing for the viola with that elegiac quality, also full of quarter tones and quarter tone vibrato and flautando sounds, which will also pop up in the sonata. So here's the Arditti Quartets recording.
Thank you.
So to continue connecting these threads of viola writing, we should talk a little bit about the music festival that Henze founded, which was called the Cantieri Internazionale d'Arte, which was in the small town of Montepulciano, Italy. Henze set this up as sort of a utopia where musicians, performers, composers, and the local townspeople could collaborate and create artworks. And like Garth Knox very eloquently put it, when you try to form a utopia, you will inevitably fail, but you have to try anyway. So it was this wonderful flowering of creation where you have, for better words, or like the folk people mixing with high-minded modern artists all coming together creating wonderful pieces of music. So in the second version of this festival, the theme is the Orpheus myth. And there was one piece that Garth was playing the viola, and he was also playing the character of Orpheus. And this was the first time that Henze met Garth Knox. So I'd like to think that it was this kind of Orpheus theatricality that exposed Henze to Garth's incredible way of playing the viola, which in turn inspired the sonata. So our timeline for the sonata, when Henze finished his Orpheus ballet, which was a major work that took him about 2 years to complete, he moved right on to writing the viola sonata, and that was at the very end of 1978. By the 1st of January 1979, he finished the slow middle section, and then finished the piece about 2 weeks later. And then a year and a half later, Garth Knox premiered it with the pianist Jan Lathan Koenig at the Vintner New Music Chamber Music Festival, and Henze was there in attendance. A couple of the themes that we'll talk about with this sonata are this idea of togetherness versus isolation, or being near somebody but not truly being together with somebody. And we'll kind of trace that, especially in the slow middle section. The piece is structured into three large parts. It's one continuous movement with three parts. In the first section, it has three smaller parts, and you'll hear similar music repeated three times, interspersed with piano solos or viola false harmonics. And this whole first main section ends with a really violent and extended piano solo. That welcomes the middle section where the viola sings, and Henze has us put our mute on the whole time. There's extended passages of melody, of slower tempos with bubbles here and there. The final section begins with the most violent outburst of the piece. And actually, the notation breaks down at a certain point, and Henze uses this type of spatial notation. And you'll clearly hear when the meter goes away and the performers are left to decide how to navigate these sections. Just a little bit about the pitch content and the interval content. I'm not a set theorist by any means. And when I was learning this piece, I just started noticing certain intervals, certain chords popping up a lot. And what I discovered is that Henze uses this one set, and it's prime form 0-1-6, which I've learned this one actually has a name called the Viennese trichord, because the Schoenberg, Berg, and Weber and crew really loved it. What Henze uses it for is that it combines the most consonant interval with the most dissonant intervals. So the consonant interval of the perfect fifth or perfect fourth, just like our open strings, plus the most dissonant intervals of the minor second and trite. This trichord pops up in a lot of different situations. It's the first three notes of the piano. It happens at the very opening of the third part in the viola section. And even in the first part, he's got, in the sixth measure, he's got four different transpositions of the set. In the final one, he does this beautiful way of overlapping two transpositions of the set to enter like the coda section of the piece. So this idea of playing together or being together but not really playing at the same time threads throughout the entire work. And this can be really seen in the first couple measures of the piece. So those two green circles are the only places where the viola and the piano strikes a note simultaneously in the first first 5 measures here. So Zach and I will just play this part. You can hear when the viola plays, the piano doesn't, and vice versa. As we move forward, another device that Henze uses to reinforce this togetherness or isolation feeling is something that he referred to as machines. And these are figures that kind of tick-tock back and forth. They don't go forwards, they don't go backwards. They just live in one place. And there's 3 notable machines in this piece. It makes a little bit of obscurity for the meter. So Zach's going to demonstrate how this actually sounds. It happens about 13 times in a row. So that's written in 12/8, but it doesn't really sound like 12/8. So now Zach's going to try to give it a real swingy 12/8 feel. So then we can listen to the pitches and how they're organized, highs and lows. And that almost sounds like 6/4. That gives it a totally different feeling. So we have this ambiguity built into just this machine. But then, to make matters even worse, on top of this, Henze overlays the viola melody in a completely different meter. So in 4/4. And this, for me, gives just this incredible image and one of the real feelings I gather from this piece, which is there's like 2 protagonists just walking together at the same time. Some of their footsteps might fall at the same time, but they're carrying on completely different conversations and they're in their own world. So it's like people are together, but they're not truly connected. So we'll play. Finally, there are a couple more attempts at communion or attempts at communication. And this happens right before the ending closing section of the piece, where you have the viola and the piano trying to be together, but ultimately failing. And it happens 3 times, as you can see here. Striking sense of isolation. This is the final system of the work, where you have these stabbing high notes in the piano, and the viola is hung out in this in its very upper register on a high D. And this actually coincides with a lot of the other endings of Henze's viola music that we've seen. So in his string quartet number 2, the viola ends on a harmonic G sharp. The compases is even higher. Quarter tone, sharp, C natural. So Henze frequently ends the viola in such a foreign and unknown register. So now Zach and I will perform Henze's viola sonata.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.